Alright, thanks for watching this video. Let's go through the quiz here. So the first question is about plotting points, and for the most part this went smoothly, but let's just remember this is x, this is y, let's not get those backwards, right? So x is 5 and y is 0, so x is 5, y is 0. Negative 5, negative 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 for the x, negative 6 for the y, there's a point, 4, 3, negative 5, 5 right there. Right. And there's the points. And if you connected these like this somehow, remember a graph is a bunch of points. I didn't give any of these points, right? There's a ton of, like here's, looks like negative 3.1 comma, or a 0 comma negative 3.1. That was not one of the points, right? So just these points, no more points. What you've done here is graphed an infinite number of points, way more than I asked for. Okay, so we don't want that. Okay, so which point is on the graph? Remember, a graph is a bunch of points. Every point represents an input and an output. So in this case, if this point is on the graph, then this must be an input and this is an output. And if not, then this must be an input and this must be an output. And if not, then neither of these points is on the graph. Okay, so I just need to test it. When I put this in, do I get this out? And so forth and so on. So 4 times 5 halves minus 2 fifths times 5. Put that over 1. I'll put this 4 over 1. Makes it easier. Does that come out to be 8? Let's see. Well, 2 cancels 4. That's 2. That's 2 times 5 is 10. 5 cancels 5. That's minus 2. And that does equal 8. So 5 halves, comma, 5 must be a point on this graph. If I were to graph it, I would find a point right at 5 halves, comma, 5. If I put in 9 fourths, 10, 9 fourths here and 10 there, I won't get 8. That's what will happen. Right. That's it for that page. All right. So I'm trying to impart upon you the very important fact that a graph is just a bunch of points, and every point represents an input and an output. Okay. And if in doubt, if you're ever in doubt of how to graph something, then plug something in for x. So I make you do it 4 times and see that the points that we find are all in a line, and that's how we know we can graph these kinds of equations as lines. Okay, so negative 3 fourths times negative 4 for 1. 2, 4 cancels 4, we get a negative 1 here, so negative 3 times negative 1 is 3, plus 2 is 5, so that's 5. 0 is too easy to do the work for. Negative 3 fourths times 0 is 0, will give us 2. Okay, y equals negative 3 fourths times positive 4, plus 2, cancel, cancel, we get negative 3, plus 2 equals negative 1. Your choice, what would you plug in here? Well, you can see how negative 4 and 4 worked out nicely. It didn't give us any fractions, so maybe 8 or negative 8. So I'll do 8, because it's positive. Y equals negative 3 fourths times 8 over 1 plus 2, cancel. Now this leaves us with a 2. Negative 3 times 2 is negative 6, plus 2 is negative 4. All right, so we have 4 points now. Of the infinite number of points, we have found 4. 1, 2, 3, 4 in the negative direction. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it's negative 4, 5, 0, 2, 4, negative 1, 8, negative 4, so right here. And you can see, if I were to plot, if I were to go to negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, I would get points probably here and, you know, somewhere in there. And if I plotted points in between, I would get these points here, something like this. I can see this pattern forming. We get this oh so beautiful straight line. Okay. All right, this was one that a lot of people had trouble with. What's the range of this graph, or the function in this graph? Remember that domain, that is all inputs, or all the x's. The range, that's all the outputs, or the y values. Here's something you can think about What things can y be? It's probably got to be less than something, less than or equal to something, or and also greater than or equal to some other thing. If we look at this graph, let me see if I can get this to stop wigging out. Okay. I can see that the smallest y value is right in here somewhere. That looks like 0.6 to me. Just kind of a guess. And I was looking for a guess. I got a guess of 0.9. That's fine. Okay. It's clearly a little bit below 1. And how high does it go? Does it go up to here? No, it goes even a little higher, all the way up to here. Here's a y value that I can have, 6. Okay, so from 0.6 to 6, or 0.5 to 6, 0.9 to 6, somewhere in there, if you had said 0.7 to 6, as long as you said like y can be from 0.7 to 6, or said it in words, or anything like that to indicate these are the things that the output can be. These are the things that y can be. That's all I wanted to know. That is the range. If we were to talk about the domain, it'd be something different. It'd be what the x values can be, but I didn't ask about that. I asked about the range, which is the outputs, which that's y. Those are the y values. All right. Graph this function. Whenever you're in doubt, plug in something for x. If you ever wonder what to plug in for x, plug in 0 for x. Negative 3 times 0, y equals 0. So we have a point at 0, 0. 0 for x gives us 0 out for y. How about 1, right? This isn't a fraction. It's not hard to multiply negative 3 times 1. Negative 3, so 1, negative 3. Right? Down 3 over 1. If I were to plug in 2, I'd get negative 6. Right? Negative 6. Right there. Down 3 over another 1. That means if I put in 3, I get out negative 9. Of course I would. Negative 3 times 3 is negative 9. Go in the negative direction, then I get positive y values. Okay? Or I have a y-intercept of 0, boom, a slope of negative 3 over 1, that's down 3 to the right 1, down 3 to the right 1, that also will do the trick. Okay. What's a solution? A solution is a set x and y, a couple of values, x and y, that you can plug into the equation, and the equation will be true. So, part A, is 1 negative 2 a solution? We need to plug it in and see. Put negative 2 in there for y, and 1 for x. Will it be true? Let's see. Negative 2 equals 3 minus 5. Negative 2 is equal to 3 minus 5. Negative 2 is equal to negative 2. So this is a solution. Part B. Need to try it again. 4. Is that what I'll get when I do 3 times 3 minus 5? 3 in for x, 4 in for y. Does it work? 4 equals 9 minus 5, 4 equals 4, yes. That's also a solution. Now we need to find a solution. That would be any x and y that works. How about 0 for x? That's easy. Negative 5 for y. How about plug in 2 for x? See what comes out for y? Let's see what happens there. Part C. I don't know what y is going to be, but I'll plug in 2 for x, and that'll tell me what y has to be. So I get 6 minus 1, or sorry, 5, getting a little too ahead of myself, 1. So if I did 2 comma 1, that would be a solution. Anything that works. Anything that doesn't work would not be a solution. How about 0, and what should I should get negative 5, so how about I put negative 4? That's not a solution, right? 0, negative 5 is a solution. How about 1 comma 12, right? I should get negative 2 for y, so if I put 12, that won't work out. A non-solution would be one that you plug the things in for x and y, and it's not true. It doesn't work. It's not a solution. Okay. So all you have to do is figure out what works and then just replace it. Like 3, 4, we know that's a solution. So how about 3, 7? That's not going to work. 3, 4 works. 3, 7 won't work. All right, what's the x-intercept? Remember, the x-intercept is a point on the x-axis, whether it be here, or here, or here, or here. I'm not sure what it's going to be, right, for this equation, but it is on the x-axis. All along the x-axis, you know what's true? Y is always 0. So I'll let y be 0 and then figure out what x would have to be. 6x equals 18, of course. If y is 0, then that goes away. And so x is 3. Or 3 comma 0 is even more proper. Okay, but this is absolutely fine. I'm fine with that. What's the y-intercept? It's kind of the opposite. It's a point on the y-axis. And all along the y-axis, x is 0, so we'll plug in x is 0, negative 7, y equals 21, that's what we get, y equals negative 3. So y equals negative 3. And we're done. Graph the linear equation. Label the x and y intercepts. It's probably important to find the x and y intercepts. That would just be plugging in 0 for x, then 0 for y, and seeing what I get for both. So 12 times 0 minus 32 times y equals 96. Negative 32y equals 96. Divide by 32, or negative 32 on both sides, you get a negative 3. So there is the y-intercept. Label it, y-intercept. You can even use an abbreviation. If I plug in 0 for y, I'll just get 12x equals 96. I'll divide by 12, divide by 12, and x is 8. X is 8. Okay, just want to make sure that that's true. And, of course, we have to graph all the other points. Right, all those other points collecting get together, making the thing we call the line. That's the x-intercept, and we're done. Okay, now we just want to plot these 2 points and find the slope of the line that passes through the points. So negative 4, 7, negative 4, negative 7, negative 4, negative 7. So negative 7 right there. All right. 5, 3, that's right there. There's a line that passes through the 2 points. We want to find the slope. The slope is just the change in y over the change in x. How much does y change between 2 points? Divided by how much does x change? This, if you count it off, it's 10. Count this off, it's 9. If you don't like counting it off, you can just take this y value. Okay, that's negative 7 minus 3 minus this y value. And then we can take negative 4 minus 5. It's negative 10 over negative 9. Negative divided by negative is positive, 10 ninths. Or negative 3 minus negative 7, and 5 minus negative 4, we'll get 10 over 9 as well. Okay, so during the first 160 minutes of a flight, a jet climbs to 57,000 feet. What is the jet's rate of change in altitude during this time? That would just be how much did the altitude change over how much did the time change? That'd be feet, that'd be minutes. Okay, round to the nearest 100. I wasn't too strict on that. But 57,000 divided by 160. What we have to do to get our calculator out. Get 356.25. 356.25. Should make sure I did that. 57,160. Yeah. And that is in feet per minute. That's a really important thing. 356.25, when I'm asking for what the rate of change is, doesn't make a lot of sense. So if it says round to the nearest 100, well, I guess then this would be 400 feet per second. Or feet per minute, excuse me. If you said 356 feet per minute or 356.25 feet per minute, that didn't matter. Really, I didn't care if you rounded correctly. I was more concerned with, did you take 57,000 divided by 160, right? How many feet per minute are we going? Well, let's take the number of feet divided by the number of minutes. How much the feet changed divided by how much the minutes changed, that's our rate of change, that's our slope, right? If we were to graph this thing as a line, that would be our slope. Like, we could do y equals 356.25x, right? And assuming that, you know, we started at an altitude of 0, that could be our equation. So if we were to graph that, that would be a line. Okay, this is an exercise in function notation. Let's start with b. B seems to be more natural. B just says h of 7. That means take the function h and plug in 7. If I plug in 7, I'll get negative 4 times 7 plus 16. That's negative 28 plus 16. That's negative 12. Negative 12. Done. Part A. See how this does not say h of 28. It does not have a 28 in there in the place of x. Right? So it does not mean put 28 in for x. If I wanted you to do that, I would have said, similar to this, h parentheses 28, which means 28 is in place of x. what is this saying? This is saying, well, h of x is the function. H of x is this. It is this. Okay, and I'm saying that it is equal to 28. So another way of saying is I don't know what the input is, but I do know the output came out to be 28. Okay, the output is 28. When we say h of x is 28, we're saying the output is 28. When we say h of 7, we're saying the input is 7. Output, input. So we solve for x. Subtract 16 for both sides, negative 4x equals 12. Divide by negative 4, x is negative 3. And it says find, you know, this is the end of the sentence, find x, when h of x is 28. So that's, it's like saying find x when y is 28. Remember, h of x and y are the same thing. We just call them by different names. We're going to graph this the fast way. Okay, we'll do the y-intercept is 8. Slope of 4/5, I purposefully made going up 4 and over 5, like outside of the grid that I gave you. So that maybe you would go down 4 and to the left 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Of course, I didn't mark it wrong. If you went up 4, which is up here, and over 5, which puts you above the grid, that's fine too. It's not a crime. There we go. Well, if we don't want to do it the short way, we're just at a loss. We don't know what this graph is supposed to look like. Plug in something for x and see what comes out for y. Or, in this case, g of x. Plug in 0, get out 8. What's next? Plug in 5, right? And you'll get out 12. Or plug in negative 5, and you'll get out 4, right? Because it'll be negative 5 in there, cancels. Will give us a 4 times negative 1, that's negative 4, plus 8 is 4. Okay. And I believe this is the last thing. What is f of negative 1/4? It means plug in negative 4th for x. So 8 times negative 1/4. Minus 15. So we take that over 1, 4's cancel, we're left with a 2 here. So that's 2 times negative 1, that's negative 2, minus 15, negative 17. And that, yes, that does it. Okay, so I hope that was helpful. If you have any questions, please do ask. I love to hear questions, I would love to hear your questions, and I would love to help you. Thanks for watching.